Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. This week, the world of technology was awash with swindlers and cheats peddling their silver-tongued lies to all and sundry, hoping to gaslight and dupe the unsuspecting masses with empty promises and garish frippery. So it was a pretty normal week, but thank goodness you're here so we can sort it all out. There were rumblings about new GPUs that aren't from AMD, NVIDIA, or Intel, as well as a few that are. There was some good news on the right to repair front from Apple, of all places, and a multitude of streamers are realizing that Streamlabs sucks for a multitude of reasons, the most recent one being blatant, low-effort plagiarism, which is always a good look. Indeed, the one glimmer of hope that shone forth this week was probably the new merch that went up for sale on my store, because even though purchasing material goods only brings one a few fleeting moments of surface-level joy, in this case, it's still totally worth it.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Corsair's new Xenion monitor, the 32QHD165, featuring an ultra-slim 32-inch 2560x1440 QHD screen with 1 millisecond moving picture response time, a 165Hz refresh rate fast IPS panel, quantum dot technology, and 100% sRGB, 100% Adobe RGB, and 98% DCI-P3 color gamut coverage for more vivid, natural colors, HDR400 support, and convenient features like the integrated multi-mount point for cameras, mics, or lighting built into the stand round out the package. So for more on Corsair's Xenion monitor, click the sponsor link in the video description. Everyone is on the lookout for new GPUs, and with the continuing shortage, people are hunting in more and more obscure places. So when news broke Thursday of a manufacturer newly entering the GPU market who is not NVIDIA, AMD, or even Intel, many took notice. The manufacturer in question is InnoSilicon. They are based in mainland China, and the GPU is the Fenghua No. 1. It's dubbed a high-performance server GPU, and notable features include PCIe 4.0 support, HDMI 2.1, and the use of GDDR6X memory. It also supports most major graphics APIs like OpenGL, OpenCL, Vulkan, and DirectX, and operating systems including Windows, Linux, and Android. So the question, of course, is can we start importing these as a functional alternative to $600 GTX 1060s anytime soon? Probably not, as Fenghua No. 1's intended use is in Chinese data centers for cloud computing, VR, AR, and AI workloads, but having another viable GPU out there to do GPU things in a world that doesn't have enough GPUs does seem like a good GPU thing. And we do have a vague idea of the potential performance, and I mean very vague, but it is something, thanks to German website Golem.de, who uncovered that Fenghua No. 1's chiplet-based design is built on underlying technology from PowerVR, and PowerVR is owned by British company Imagination Technologies, who was acquired by a Chinese investor group called Canyon Bridge Capital Partners in 2017. Canyon Bridge puts Imagination in touch with InnoSilicon, and there you go. The best-known PowerVR GPU configuration right now would push about 6 teraflops FP32, though, in terms of raw performance, which would very theoretically put it in the same league as an NVIDIA RTX 2060 or a Radeon RX 580. Speaking of the RTX 2060, it really does sound like NVIDIA will be bringing it out of retirement for one more round with a doubled up memory allotment, increasing from 6 to 12 gigabytes of GDDR6. The RTX 2060 originally launched in January 2019, that magical time when GPUs were plentiful and there were at least slightly fewer justifications for your chronic existential dread. The 12GB 2060 seems all but assured now, though, as the blabbermouths at the Eurasian Economic Commission have once again broadcasted early info. 4GB model numbers for cards that they recently registered, indicating that the 12-nanometer GPUs are in production once again. It's still unknown which die variant it would ship with, as there are several that would fit, including the TU106-410 from the 2060 Super that has more CUDA cores. The hope is that these might not just sell out at MSRP like every other GPU, but RTX 2060 mining profitability is still decent, and used 6GB cards are selling for $500 to $600, so don't get your hopes up. Still, any available GPU in the budget range would be better than nothing, or better than GT710s and 730s, which are worse than nothing because of the terrible curse that they carry. The unconfirmed announcement date for the 12GB 2060 is December 7th. For now. But that's not all. NVIDIA has another bone to throw hungry PC gamers, and it's called NVIDIA Image Scaling, which isn't DLSS, but kinda does a similar thing by making frames rendered at lower resolutions look better, allowing for better frame rates. It is actually just an upgrade to NVIDIA's existing image scaler, so it's more like AMD's FidelityFX Super Resolution, and it's going to be open source, like AMD FSR2. Hey, what a coincidence. That means NVIDIA image scaling could also work on AMD and Intel GPUs, and sure, maybe even the Fenghua number 1-2 eventually. So even if this is just NVIDIA saying, hey, we can do FSR 2, it's another tool gamers can use to eke a few more frames out of their GPUs, which will be especially welcome to those who are still doing their best to get by with aging graphics cards. Those of you who are struggling through these dark times with nothing but a Radeon HD 6850 or a GTX 970 3.5 gig to support your gaming needs can at least take solace in the fact that GPU manufacturers themselves are making huge steaming buttloads of cash, mountains of money, a veritable golden shower of actual gold bars. Case in point, on Wednesday, NVIDIA CEO and man who I really hope signs the adoption papers I sent him, Jensen Huang, revealed their revenue for the last quarter, an all-time record $7.1 billion, up 50% year over year, and also probably too much money. I'm expecting they'll realize that soon and announce partial refunds for anyone who has bought an overpriced GPU in the past year. Last line was a joke, just to be clear, please don't contact me because NVIDIA won't give you money. If you're wondering where NVIDIA will go from here though, don't worry, the next GPU challenge has already arrived in the form of these absurdly spec'd TVs from TCL, a 32-inch 4K 240Hz LCD, as well as a tease for a 75-inch 8K 265Hz micro LED TV. Showcased at the Global Display Tech Ecosystem Conference in Shanghai, China, the 32-inch gaming display features an R800 curve, but display outsources to drive the combination of high resolution and refresh rate do not currently exist, with HDMI 2.1 only managing 4K 240Hz with display stream compression enabled, and who wants to deal with that? Probably better to wait for DisplayPort 2.0 to finally roll out, which is expected along with new GPU launches in 2022. As for that 75-inch, don't hold your breath, as an 8K 265Hz signal will require around 205 gigabits per second of bandwidth, more than four times what HDMI 2.1 currently provides. So that one is already well ahead of the technology curve. Meanwhile, Streamlabs has drawn the wrong kind of attention this week by launching a product that they call Streamlabs Studio, which not only features the same functionality as competitor Lightstream Studio, but also the same product landing page, which they clearly and blatantly plagiarized down to the marketing copy, which was probably copied, then pasted, then they just switched Lightstream out for Streamlabs Studio before publishing it for the world to see like an overconfident middle schooler. Lightstream quickly picked up on the similarities and tweeted a side-by-side comparison that triggered an avalanche of follow-ups from individuals and other companies who had experienced Streamlabs shenanigans in the past, like Elgato, who didn't take kindly to Streamlabs ripping off the name Stream Deck, which was already a popular Elgato product, or OBS. Yes, the insanely popular open source streaming and video capture software that I use too, which Streamlabs took, forked, and then called Streamlabs OBS, despite many protests from OBS developers who knew that Streamlabs was still including OBS in the name to obfuscate the relationship between the two now disparate pieces of software. And it worked. Many, many people are unaware that OBS and SLOBS are very different, with the Streamlabs fork being heavily monetized as well versus OBS, which is totally free. And this isn't an anomaly from Streamlabs, it is very much their business model. Take someone else's work that they've graciously made open source, create a fork, build in monetization and pay-to-use functions wherever humanly possible, and engage in branding practices to blur the lines between the Streamlabs version and the free version. Twitter threads are awash with replies from smaller developers like Join Combo, who created a free service to transfer Twitch clips to TikTok, which Streamlabs copied and called CrossClip, which is, of course, a paid service. To be fair, Streamlabs has responded now that the criticism has gained so much momentum, claiming that the plagiarized Streamlabs Studio page was placeholder text that went into production by error, which is obviously not true if you know how placeholder text works. They've also pinned a note to their Twitter profile saying that they'll take immediate action to remove OBS from their name, which is nice and all, but maybe they should have just not done that in the first place when OBS specifically asked them not to use OBS in the name back when Streamlabs OBS first launched. Back then, Streamlabs responded by trademarking that name instead, which was just a dick move. One company who has remained tight-lipped through this whole thing has been Logitech, though, parent company of Streamlabs, who acquired them in 2019. So if you'd like to express your feelings about this situation in an effective manner, consider getting in touch with Logitech and telling them how you feel Streamlabs' behavior reflects on their company. For more on this, I'll also recommend the Epos Vox video linked in the description. And remember, kids, don't rip off other people's stuff and call call it your own. It reflects poorly on your character. Speaking of ripoffs, next I have a few bits of quick tech info, truncated for brevity, which I call Tech Briefs. It's a very unique segment in a format that has never been used before. The right to repair movement is one that many DIY PC builders are completely behind, so Apple's surprise self-service repair announcement Wednesday was met with tentative optimism. Kicking off in early 2022, the program will allow home tinkerers to repair their devices with genuine Apple manuals, tools, and parts, starting with iPhones, with Mac PCs like the newer M1 powered units soon to follow. Skeptics point out that the change was likely prompted by the shareholder resolution on the matter from back in September, as well as growing demand from consumers who see the benefits of reusing existing devices rather than buying new ones with every launch. MediaTek announced their new Dimensity 9000 flagship SoC on Thursday, taking a swing at the likes of Apple and Samsung in the smartphone market. This will apparently be the first silicon to market based on TSMC's N4 or 4 nanometer node, and will feature an ARM V9 SoC, a new Mali G710 GPU, and LPDDR5X compatibility. Impressive specs and estimated performance across the board, and devices will start to ship in 2022, but they'll also need to keep an eye on Qualcomm's Snapdragon 898 chip, which is expected to debut at their tech summit on November 30th. Side note, every time I see this product name, I hear George McFly saying, "You're my Dimensity." The YouTube dislike counter has started to disappear for many users across the globe, but some are holding out for a last-minute backtrack. Adding to the chorus of disapproval, YouTube co-founder Jawed Karim updated the description on his Me at the Zoo video, the first video on the platform, stating, "When all YouTubers agree that removing dislikes is a stupid idea, it probably is. Try again, YouTube." In particular, I appreciated this breakdown. The ability to easily and quickly identify bad content is an essential feature of a user-generated content platform. Why? Because not all user-generated content is good. It can't be. In fact, most of it is not good. And that's okay. The idea was never that all content is good. The idea was, however, that among the flood of content, there are great creations waiting to be exposed. And for that to happen, the stuff that's not great has to fall by the side as quickly as possible. I completely agree. In-game cheating is a blight upon online gaming in particular, and Activision is apparently taking anti-cheat measures to the next level. Extreme or repeated violations can now result in permanent suspension of all your accounts in every Call of Duty game, including unreleased future titles. It remains to be seen if the threat of permanent cross-title bans will effectively reduce cheating, but they'll roll out the policy with their new Ricochet kernel mode anti-cheat system, which goes live in December. CNET took a tour of Intel's massive Fab 42 in Arizona this week, sharing a collection of beautiful photos of upcoming chips. Sapphire Rapids server chips that launch next year, a wafer of Meteor Lake test chips, you got some clean looking substrate shots, Ponte Vecchio accelerators destined for the Aurora supercomputer, and even Meteor Lake test chips and packaging shots for CPUs that won't hit retail until 2023. Perhaps most exciting, though, was the picture of this dirt lot, future site of Fab 52 and Fab 62, which will cost $10 billion each and hopefully spin up in 2024. The chip shortage really can't end soon enough. Finally, the 200 most common passwords for 2021 has been published in a list by NordPass. And while classics like 123456 and Password are still high in the rankings, I like to browse it for slightly less well-known options, like MySpace One, a sleeper ranked at number 54, which still takes 3 hours to crack, or the all lucky sevens in spot 30 for you Final Fantasy buffs out there. The real big brain move was for the geniuses who used to go with football, ranked at number 60, but then decided to vastly increase their cybersecurity by going with Football One, taking them to spot 153. That sure is a killer password, and definitely one that you should keep secret. Update your passwords, everyone. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week, and you should now be primed and ready to face the holiday shopping melee that's already underway. Stick to online sales is my advice. Your feedback is always welcome, though, so please feel free to leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the description if you're interested in further reading. You can also click the like button if you enjoyed this video. Check out my store at paulshardware.net for a selection of excellent merchandise options, including new 8-bit designs and RGB thumbscrew keycaps, and subscribe to my channel if you'd like to see more videos like this one in the future. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.